guys, I have been getting a ton of questions from you over the last few months regarding my thoughts on CBD, and I have been wanting to make a video about this forever, but this is a huge topic. Like, the more I got into the research, the more overwhelmed I got by how much stuff there was to look into, and it's just, is big. So ultimately what I decided is that I want this video to be like a good overview of the theoretical benefits of CBD, kind of the science behind it, how people are making these claims, whether or not they're legitimate, etc. I'm also doing my own little personal experiment taking CBD, so I'll have that video for you guys with my whole experience, thoughts, opinions, etc. in like a few weeks. As you probably know, CBD is super trendy right now. They're putting CBD in everything. There's CBD ice cream, there's CBD potato chips, there's CBD mascara, literally you name it, there's probably a product with CBD in it right now. And the reason it's gathering so much momentum is that advocates for CBD are kind of framing it as a cure-all. Kind of wanted to just take a dive into the basis for these claims and kind of where they're coming from and how they may or may not make some sense. So if you're excited to learn more about the benefits and science behind CBD, go ahead and give this video a big thumbs up, and then make sure you hit that subscribe button to follow me along my CBD journey, exploring and discovering the world of hemp, I suppose. First, I want to start with a really quick little CBD book recommendation. Whenever I start researching a new topic and kind of want to get like a basis or a foundation from which to start my own research, I immediately go to podcasts and audiobooks. So I was looking through my podcast and found an interview with author Gretchen Litaker on the Genius Life podcast, which is Max Lugavere's podcast, and found that interview absolutely fascinating. So I immediately downloaded her book from Audible. It's called CBD Oil Everyday Secrets, and I found it to be a fantastic, just basic overview of CBD. So if you finish this video and decide that you want to learn more about CBD, I definitely recommend you go download that book from Audible. As always, this month's book recommendation is brought to you by Audible, aka my favorite audiobook platform, or I guess the only audiobook platform that I use because it's the best. And right now they're running a special deal in celebration of Prime Month. If you are an Amazon Prime member, you can get 3 months of Audible for the price of one. So that comes out to $4.95 per month, and then after that it's $14.95 per month. This also gets you access to Audible Originals, which are exclusive audio titles created by celebrated storytellers from worlds as diverse as literature, journalism, theater, etc. So if you want to get hooked up with a special deal for Audible, go to audible.com/Marissa or text Marissa to 500-500. I love using Audible to help me stay on top of current research with health and fitness. If there's ever a new fad or trend that comes out, audiobooks are one of the first places that I go to get kind of like a baseline of information. So highly recommend. Again, that's audible.com/Marissa or text Marissa to 500-500. So without further ado, CBD. Cannabis has been used medicinally for literally thousands of years. In fact, it was the third most prescribed pharmaceutical in the US for 60 years leading up to the 1930s, when it started to become regulated as a drug, and then it was just banned completely in the 1970s. So it was a huge part of like human society until very recently. But it's exploding right now because we're just starting to really understand how it works. CBD interacts with something called the endocannabinoid system in the body, and we will talk about that in a second, but the first endocannabinoid was discovered in just 1992. That's not that long ago. This field of research is extremely new. Our understanding of this system of the body is in its complete infancy compared to our understanding of any other system of the body that we actually know about. And speaking of the endocannabinoid system, this is where we need to start, because once you understand what the endocannabinoid system does in the body, you can start to understand how people are making all of the claims that they're making about CBD. Just as the body has a digestive system, a nervous system, etc., it also has an endocannabinoid system. And the function of the endocannabinoid system is to maintain homeostasis in the body, or just to balance out the body. It helps the body regulate everything from hormones to temperature to heart rate to hunger signals, etc. Like, it helps regulate basically everything in the body. The endocannabinoid system is composed of three things: cannabinoid receptors, cannabinoids, and enzymes. Let's start with cannabinoid receptors. These are receptors found on the surface of cells that are responsive to cannabinoids. And there are two main types of cannabinoid receptors. There are other receptors that are responsive to cannabinoids, but we're gonna focus on the two main ones. The first one is CB1, and this is found mostly in the central nervous system, so the brain and the spinal cord, but they're also found in internal organs, connective tissue, and glands. So this means that the CB1 receptors are mostly responsible for regulating things like mood, appetite, coordination, pain, movement, etc. CB2 receptors, on the other hand, are found mostly in the peripheral nervous system, as well as in specialized immune cells. So this means they help regulate inflammation as well as immune function. And then they're also found in the digestive system, spleen, and tonsils. So those are the cannabinoid receptors. They're sitting on the surface of the cells waiting for cannabinoids to just come along and influence them. So that brings us to the cannabinoids themselves. Now, cannabinoid is a term for a lot of chemically similar compounds. There are endocannabinoids, which are ones that are naturally formed in the body. So yes, you naturally have cannabinoids that are formed in your body without intaking them through any other method. But then there are phytocannabinoids. These are formed in plants. So this is what is in the hemp plant, as in CBD, THC, CBG, etc. There are, I think, over at least 100 different phytocannabinoids just found in the hemp plant. And then you can, of course, synthetically create cannabinoids as well. But for right now, we're just going to focus on the two that are inherent to the endocannabinoid system. So these are endocannabinoids, the ones that are naturally formed in your body. There are just two that we need to focus on. There's two main ones. And these are called anandamide and 2-AG. You can think of them both as feel-good chemicals. Anandamide is actually named as the bliss molecule. It comes from some word in some language that means bliss. It's a compound that's released when you're meditating. It's also associated with the runner's high feeling, and it has been shown to potentially inhibit cancer cell growth. 2-AG is kind of similar, and it's also found in breast milk. So yes, you're literally feeding your baby a compound that is structurally vaguely similar to one found in weed. Assuming you're breastfeeding, of course. But what this indicates is that cannabinoids are critically important for not only human function, but human development. Deficiency in these two endocannabinoids has been shown to influence things like anxiety and depression, fibromyalgia, irritable bowel syndrome, and migraines. And one of the ways you can become deficient is through the activity of the third part of the endocannabinoid system, the enzymes. There are special metabolic enzymes whose role it is to break down the endocannabinoids as soon as they are used. With a lot of other hormones and systems in the body, the substances can hang around longer for minutes or hours in the body, they can get stored, but with endocannabinoids, they're like a one-time use, you use it, you lose it, kind of deal. And this is to make sure that, like, you don't unbalance in the opposite direction. So if levels of something are too high, endocannabinoids come in and bring it back down. You don't want them accidentally pushing you further down, so they're destroyed so that you stay at your base level that you're supposed to be at. So if these enzymes are functioning poorly and they are overactive, this has been shown to cause a deficiency in anandamide. And this has been shown to be particularly true in neuropathic pain as well as Alzheimer's disease. So far you've learned about the three main elements of the endocannabinoid system: the cannabinoid receptors, the cannabinoids themselves, and the enzymes that regulate cannabinoid activity. How it works is that the cannabinoids are retrograde messengers. So think of it this way. If there's two neurons together, so this is like neuron axons, neuron head, and so this one's signaling to this one, right? So you got a little gap, this is where the little messengers go through, and it's signaling. Say this one is firing like way too much, like it's going crazy. This neuron's gonna be like, hey, you need to calm down. And the way it's gonna say that is it's going to start producing endocannabinoids that are gonna go over here and go on to the endocannabinoid receptors of the first neuron, and it's gonna tell it to calm down. So it's gonna be going like that, and then it's gonna be like nice and calm, and then your body comes back into balance. That was a really bad explanation, but I hope the visual helps it make more sense. So this system, the endocannabinoid system, is the largest neurotransmitter system in the body, and it's found in almost every single system of the body. So it's thought to regulate a ton of different things. And this is why CBD is thought to help with so many different things, because the system that it interacts with is pervasive throughout the body. So now that we understand the endocannabinoid system, let's dive into the phytocannabinoids and take a look at how they influence the body. But here's the thing with CBD. There is very, very little research on it, and most of the research on it is done in test tubes and on mice. There are not a lot of good clinical trials done on humans when it comes to CBD. So a lot of the claims that you see being made are not really 100% validated yet. Just because we don't have the data yet doesn't mean that it isn't there, doesn't mean that these people are inherently wrong. It just means that we haven't studied it well yet. So all this is to say, everything that I'm about to say is a lot more theoretical. There is not a lot of concrete evidence to back up most of the claims. THC is the best studied cannabinoid and is much more simple as far as its function goes, so let's start there. Basically, THC is really, really similar in structure to anandamide, which is an endocannabinoid. So if it's into the same receptor that anandamide does, and this is the CB1 receptor. So usually with anandamide, it comes in, goes to the CB1 receptor, does its thing, and then it gets eaten up by the enzyme. THC comes in, it fits into the CB1 receptor, but the difference is that the enzyme doesn't recognize THC as an endocannabinoid, so it doesn't get broken down by the enzyme. So it ends up hanging around in the body a lot longer, and this is what produces the high, which kind of makes a ton of sense. Anandamide is the bliss molecule. When you have a ton of bliss molecules in your body that aren't going away like they're supposed to, kind of makes sense that you would get high. Now, CBD is not as structurally similar to either of the endocannabinoids, so it doesn't interact with the receptors the same way. It doesn't just fit into the receptors nicely like anandamide or 2-AG do. Instead, it is an allosteric modulator of the cannabinoid receptors. So what this means is it can bind to the receptors in other ways that help either upregulate or downregulate certain activity. So for example, CBD can bind to the cannabinoid receptors in such a way that it causes the cells to start upregulating their production of anti-inflammatory biochemicals. It can also help upregulate the production of GABA, which is very calming to the central nervous system. Something it can help downregulate is the production of inflammatory biochemicals. It can also help downregulate things like glutamate, which is very excitatory to the central nervous system. And then, on top of interacting directly with the cannabinoid receptors, CBD can also interact with the endocannabinoid enzymes. It can block their function and help upregulate production of anandamide. So that's kind of a brief overview of how CBD works in the endocannabinoid system. Basically, what I want to make clear is that it's not a direct replacement of the endocannabinoids. Instead, it influences the endocannabinoid system to upregulate and downregulate certain things. You now know how the endocannabinoid system works and how CBD interacts with it. Now it's time for probably the moment you've all been waiting for, going through some of the benefits of CBD and breaking down some of the science behind it. Again, there's not a lot of human studies. So just right off the bat, most of this is still kind of more theoretical. I've picked some of my personal favorite benefits of CBD as well as some of the more popular reasons that people use it. I would be here all day. This video would be 24 hours long if I actually tried to go through all of the benefits and break down all of the science. So, gonna try to keep this like short, sweet, but also informational. So the first one, and where I personally believe it has the potential to have some of the greatest impact, is inflammation. There's a lot of things that we are exposed to just as a modern society that can cause inflammation. And inflammation has been shown to contribute to so many different chronic diseases and things like Alzheimer's, anxiety, depression, etc. So if we could just all be not inflamed, our collective health would greatly improve. So there's a few good scientific reviews that I found that looked at CBD's role in inflammation, and both of them basically concluded that yes, CBD can be anti-inflammatory. The first review showed that CBD did have anti-inflammatory effects on immune cells such as macrophages and microglia, and the second review stated that, and I quote, The endocannabinoid system is also involved in immunoregulation. For example, the administration of endocannabinoids or use of inhibitors of the enzymes that break down the endocannabinoids led to immunosuppression and recovery from immune-mediated injury to organs such as the liver. So CBD does indeed look like it has the potential to help with inflammation. One of the next important potential benefits of CBD is helping regulate stress. Now, this one's pretty straightforward in how it actually interacts in the body. So CBD, because of how it interacts with the enzymes and the receptors, can upregulate the production of anandamide. And when you have higher levels of anandamide, it lowers your cortisol levels. So if you have chronic stress, if your cortisol levels are constantly elevated, then CBD can potentially help alleviate some of that. Another way that CBD has the potential to help a lot of people is through improving depression. So one of the things, this is a huge topic again, but one of the things that I looked at is that depression is often associated with some degrading of a certain part of the hippocampus in the brain. And so CBD, with the way it functions in the body, is able to stimulate certain factors that can help repair and regrow that section of the brain. So the first thing is, of course, it can stimulate the production of increased anandamide in that region, which will help with neuron repair and growth. And then there were some mice studies that showed that CBD can also increase the production of BDNF, which is brain-derived nootropic factor, which is basically just a factor that can also boost neuron growth. But there were also some mouse studies that completely contradicted this, so who knows? When it comes to CBD and anxiety, there actually is one really good human study on this subject, which is really exciting. What they basically did is they took a bunch of people with social anxiety disorder and they gave them a wide range of different amounts of CBD. So some were placebo and then some had different amounts of CBD. And what they found is that when they gave them a like public speaking tests, they made them all just like speak publicly and measure different factors, that the group that was given 300 milligrams of CBD had a noticeable decrease in anxiety, cognitive impairment, and discomfort when compared to the placebo. The annoying thing about this study is that they showed that the most effective dose for this was 300 milligrams. So less than this wasn't as effective and more than this was not as effective. So that was kind of the sweet spot. 300 milligrams of CBD is a lot of CBD when you're going by like the standard CBD oil bottles that you would buy like in a store. You'd have to drink a lot of the bottle. And that just costs a lot of money if you're getting quality CBD. Next up is gut health, which is the reason that I am currently taking CBD. Now there's actually a lot less concrete data on this, but because of what we know about how the endocannabinoid system functions, there's a lot that we can extrapolate and kind of assume about how it would help the gut. There's two main ways that CBD has the potential to help with leaky gut or intestinal permeability. The first is that there are cannabinoid receptors along the small intestine that are responsible for maintaining the integrity of like the tight junctions that keep the gut from being permeable. The second thing, and I find this extremely fascinating, is that there appears to be some amount of crosstalk between the endocannabinoid system and the microbiota of the gut, which could in turn affect leaky gut. And finally, assuming CBD does actually improve inflammation, that alone can help improve gut health. So those were all the benefits that I wanted to talk about, but there's one more benefit that I want to talk about that I'm not really buying based on my research, but is being promoted all over the place by like famous Instagram people. And this is taking CBD for exercise purposes, taking it pre and post workout. I do see some potential benefit of taking it before a workout if it helps you focus and really get in the zone, but it's not actually going to improve exercise performance. But where I don't really like this idea is that CBD theoretically should help your body balance itself. The purpose of exercise, or at least for most people trying to achieve goals, the purpose of exercise is to push your body past where it's comfortable. It's to push it to a point where it has to work hard to adapt to the stimulus that you're giving it. So if you put CBD in your body, that's going to inherently help your body adapt to that stimulus, so your body won't have to work as hard and thus it won't have to change as much to adapt, and so your adaptation process would be slower. Now, I couldn't find like any good research on any of this. This is just kind of my theory in how this would work, but I don't really see any benefits in taking it post-workout as far as getting more out of your workout goes. And then people are taking it post-workout to help with muscle soreness and recovery. I don't like that at all, personally. The inflammation that your body goes through after your workout is necessary for recovery. Like, there's a certain amount of inflammation that is okay for your body, that's good for your body. Once you push past that, yeah, you should do what you can to reduce inflammation. But if you're training so hard that you're causing your body to be overinflamed constantly, you're probably just overtraining and would benefit a lot more from just backing off the training rather than slapping a band-aid on it with CBD and saying, oh look, now I can train harder because I'm recovering faster. Like, no, you're just overtraining and you would get more out of training appropriately for what your body can handle without you putting CBD in it. But just to be fair, I have never taken CBD pre and post workout. Maybe I will experiment with that. Let me know down in the comments if you want me to actually experiment with that and see if it does anything. Maybe that'll completely change my mind. But it just, I don't really see the logic or the science in it right now. But if you guys have any other evidence to present to me, if I'm just completely off base, let me know. So last but not least, potential side effects and drawbacks. Overall, CBD is thought to be extraordinarily safe. In a lot of the research, there's no known side effects. It's thought to be non-addictive. And so overall, like for most people, it appears to be good to go, even in very high doses. However, some people do experience side effects, and there are a wide range of side effects that people have experienced from taking CBD. I don't recommend going out there just like trying CBD thinking there's no way there's gonna be a side effect for you, because there may be. And then I just want to caution against blindly taking CBD chronically, so like every single day for years. There's just not enough research to know what potential side effects that could have for the body long term. And I think there's really something to be said for letting your body experience some amount of stress. You know, there's eustress and distress. Eustress is like good stress. There is such a thing as good stressors on the body. They help your body adapt, they help your body learn new things and grow, etc. Then there's distress, which like overall, probably not great to experience. But I personally think it makes a lot of sense that our bodies should be allowed to experience some amount of eustress and be able to adapt to that by themselves without the use of a supplement. And we already know that THC by itself does downregulate the activity of the endocannabinoid system. Now, CBD has not been shown to do that, but I personally am going to be cautious taking it because I wouldn't want to be taking CBD for so long that my body downregulates its ability to cope with stress on its own. And then if I go off CBD, I'm now much less prepared to deal with stress. Again, the research doesn't prove either way. I just prefer to be cautious. And then another thing to be aware of is using it as a band-aid for an issue that could be caused by something else that really should be fixed and focused on, but you can't fix it because CBD is already fixing it and it's still hanging around there festering, but you just don't know. So like a lot of people rely on CBD to be able to sleep. Having to take CBD every single night to go to sleep is an indicator that something else is off in your body. If you have some sort of like disease or disorder that is impossible to like recover from and CBD is the only thing that helps, like that makes sense. But if there's something that you don't know about that's preventing you from sleeping, working to finding that thing and getting your body in balance by itself without a band-aid is probably the best strategy. And then use CBD on those times when, you know, maybe you are having a harder time falling asleep. But if you're relying on it day in and day out, chances are there's something else going on that you would benefit a lot more from fixing. So I guess my overall opinion on CBD is it does seem that it could potentially have a ton of the benefits that people are claiming that it does have. But the research is very new, in its infancy. We don't really know much about long-term chronic use, so be cautious. And I think that's just about all I have to say about CBD for today. If you guys want to do your own deeper dives into CBD, I actually compiled a little PDF of some of my favorite places that I was learning about CBD from. So there are some great videos that go really in depth. There's some different articles that you can reference that have a lot of different sources cited if you want to read like actual scientific studies and stuff like that. So I will link that down in the description box below. Also, let me know what your experiences are with CBD down in the comments. as someone who is kind of new to this space, I've only recently just started taking CBD. I'm really curious to see how it is affecting other people from the mouths of people that are not being paid to talk about CBD and specific brands of CBD. So all of you guys, let me know what your experience is with it. In the meantime, if you liked this video, I really would appreciate if you gave it a big thumbs up. I spent hours and hours coming through research for this, so that would, a little thumbs up would help give me more confidence to keep doing stuff like this. Please share this video with your friends, your family, your neighbors. If you wanna see more health and fitness related content from me, you can check that out over here. In the meantime, if you wanna see my future videos about CBD, make sure you hit that subscribe button and turn on the little notification bell to make sure you are notified when I upload a new video. And I will see you very, very soon. Bye.